recording that first. So, the agenda. Members are there, papers have been distributed. Preliminary matters. Declarations of interest. Anybody declaring interest? Councillor Ray?
Thank you, Chair. Can I declare an interest in item number 7 in relation to the Wirral Youth Zone? I bet you've been a Wirral councillor. It's a little bit loose. I'm not sure that I have to, but right. On the side of caution.
Other Wirral members will perhaps want to do the same.
And I also should say that I've been on the steering group of the Wirral Youth Zone for a number of years before it became into, morphed into a board. So.
Okay.
Well, I'm also a board councillor.
It's non-pecuniary.
It is,
it's
non-pecuniary.
It's just for the fullness of information, I imagine. Any additional items of business, we dealt with that. Items which require exclusion, we come to the pink pages, there are some down there if we need to. They may be just, we don't refer to them, we don't need to remove the press and public. Yeah, that's what I mean. If we have to discuss anything on the pink papers, then we'll have to move press and public. If the pink papers aren't to be discussed, then we're okay. So, 2 minutes of previous meetings, pages 7 to 10. Are there any changes or amendments, items of factuality to change? Not, can those be agreed? Thank you. So we move to the meat of the agenda, item 3, audit findings, pages 11 to 44.
Sorry, Chair. Just to introduce the report, the authorities required to produce a statement of accounts based on specific regulations and codes. That's later on in the agenda, item 4, but before they can consider the statement of accounts, the documents have to be audited and must consider the auditor's report. Consider item 4. So Mike Thomas is here from Grant Thornton, who are our auditors. I'll hand over to Mike if that's okay, and he can present the findings, and then we can move on to item 4 and consider the statement, if that's okay with members.
Yes, well, you're very welcome. Good to see you here.
Thank you.
Over to you.
Thank you, Chair. As Ian said, Mike Thomas, I'm director of Grant Thornton. I think I've shown my age because I thought our typeface was small, but when it comes into your paper, it's even smaller. So I'll take you through the report and
with a magnifying glass
and just give you some of the highlights. I mean, maybe first by starting with a thank you to Ian and his team. The timetable around the accounts is getting ever more challenging and will continue to do so going forward. But we, as in previous years, with my predecessor, had good cooperation from the team and received a good set of accounts and working papers, which is always really helpful in getting through the process and getting to the end of the process against the timetable. In respect of the report itself, I mean, the main findings are in the executive summary on 13, 14 and 15 of your pages. And the pleasing things to note are that we will issue an unqualified opinion on the financial statements, hopefully once you've got through today's meeting tomorrow. So that will then be available for the conclusion of the audit. In terms of our other responsibilities around value for money, again, issuing a unqualified conclusion around the value for money work we do around your arrangement for value for money. But as members will see from within the text reflects the fact that the situation is becoming more and more challenging as the years go on, and certainly in the context of the three-year financial plan that you've currently got, then will be increasingly difficult to achieve, I think, is the message I would like you to take away. We've completed our work on whole of government accounts, and that is reflected back in the certificate we will give you in relation to the conclusion of the audit. And then we're required just to feed back any issues around internal control, and I'm pleased to say there's none that have come out of the work that we've done that we'd like to bring to your attention. The report itself, in terms of the detail, goes through sort of page by page in relation to the financial statements, what was identified in our audit plan earlier in the year as audit risks, and we've just documented the issues coming out of those, and also particularly around accounting policies, estimates and judgments where your accountants are required to make decisions, but we review those and challenge them, are they in line with the guidance and the procedures and the accounting standards that Ian alluded to in his introduction. So, Chair, overall in relation to the audit itself, there are no changes to the numbers in the accounts. There are some disclosures, a very small number of disclosure changes that have been reflected in the final version of the accounts. And other than that, Chair, I would just say the other points that are made within the report, some detail around value for money, but towards the back then, there's just some confirmation of our final fees for the year and some other communication requirements, one of which is the letter of representation, which was the document that's just been circulated. And I think the idea is that will be taken after Ian has done his presentation on the main statements, and you'll be asked to confirm your agreement to that letter, which it essentially is a standard letter that we issue, all officers would issue, confirming that there's nothing that you've not brought to our attention as part of the audit process. So, Chair, I'm happy to sort of finish there and take any questions if needed.
Thank you very much. Well, we've generally enjoyed good responses back from auditors over the past number of years. Generally had a light touch. We do have an audit subcommittee as well that deals with these issues in slightly more detail, perhaps. Are there any questions from members on these papers before us? No. Thank you. Thank you very much. So, Ian?
Thanks, Chair. Item four on today's agenda. At the end of each financial year, the authority is required to prepare various financial statements and include them in the statements of accounts. The statements of accounts then have to be approved by members before the 30th of September. And on agenda item four, appendix A is the statements of accounts for 2014-15. Members have already heard from the auditors that they intend to give an unqualified opinion to the statements of accounts. And I do appreciate the statements of accounts. It's a very technical and difficult document to follow. So I think, first of all, I direct members to paragraph 5 on page 44. It basically confirms the outturn position that was reported to you back in the end of June hasn't changed. And that's the most important fact to take away in terms of the financial outturn and the impact it has on the budget. The report then goes on from paragraph 6 to 9. To talk about the code and the regulations that we have to adhere to when we prepare the statements of accounts. I suppose one of the significant factors in that is that we have to input a significant amount of self-balancing entries that are not consistent with the general fund and can lead to a lot of confusion. And what I'm referring to, if I point you to page 46, the table that's there, you'll see the bottom of that table, it indicates a deficit position, £58 million. But we clearly didn't make a deficit of £58 million. That's a more favourable position. But it's all these self-balancing technical adjustments that we have to put in here, the code and regulations, to convert our accounts from a local authority-based to a private sector-based set of accounts. The report goes on to explain the significant changes between the 2014-15 figures compared to 13-14, and I direct members to page 47, section C, where I talk about the balance sheets and the changes that, between the two figures, and the bottom line is that the major changes, the significant changes, are all to do with these self-balancing entries, particularly around the pension fund, where to convert the accounts from a local authority to a private sector, we're required to reflect the liability of our pension accounts. The firefighters' pension accounts are a funded scheme, and the government do not require us to put entries in to fund any deficits. We just need the cost as and when they arise. I'm asking members now to approve the 2014 statement of accounts, that's appendix A, and approve the letter of representation, the revised letter of representation that we've got in appendix B. I'm happy to take any questions, but I do appreciate it's a very technical document, statement of accounts. Can we assure members that the position hasn't changed for that report at the end of June, but I'm happy to take any questions.
Members, any questions? My question would be just on page 3, why is that paragraph in red?
That's the change. What we produced in the original pack and appendix B, very late on we got a request from external audit because there's an issue going on about historic commutations. We haven't had the figures finalised yet, they're still being worked on by our pension administrators. So the paragraph in red, it just covers that liability to say we've not got the figures, and that we don't see that that will have any impact on the bottom line when those figures are there.
Colleagues, any questions? Right, so is that a report and these papers agreed?
Agreed, please.
And then we've got the letter here which will be sent back. Is that agreed?
That's agreed.
Okay, thank you very much. So we can move on to five, financial review. Ian again.
Thanks, Chair. The report covers the first 3 months of the financial year 2015-16. The report format is consistent with the previous reports we brought to members. Page 163, paragraph 5, outlines the format. The first item, item A, we've already covered in the previous report about the outturn position. Page 164 through to 168 outlines the revenue, capital and reserve position in the first 3 months. If I direct members to the table on page 165, that table shows the progress in delivering the saving options that members have approved over the last spending review. And the good news is that of the £22 million worth of savings that that PV covers, there's only a small minor, £78,000 worth of savings yet to be formally implemented, but we're expecting that to be actioned in the next few weeks. The table on page 166 shows the forecast outturn position on the revenue accounts, and as members can see in the last column, that, as you would expect in the first 3 months, we're still expecting a neutral position on the revenue. The table on page 167 highlights the changes in the approved capital programme. Members will note the approved capital programme has increased by around £8 million. And this is due to £3.8 million of rephasing of schemes from 2014-15 into 15-16, as reported to members on the 30th of June, the outturn report. And in addition, the inclusion of the sorghum massive scheme of £4.2 million, which members approved in report CFO 05815. The updated capital programme to reflect this £8 million has been attached to the report as Appendix B and C. Paragraph 18 on page 168 confirms the general revenue reserve has remained unchanged at £2 million, and Appendix A4 on page 179 outlines the drawdown of £186,000 worth of approved earmarked reserves in the first quarter to fund schemes that have been rephased from 2014-15. Treasury management activities outlined on page 168 through to 170 have been consistent with the approved treasury management strategy, and investments totaling £15.4 million were held by the service at the end of June and are outlined on the table on page 169. Paragraphs 25 on page 170 confirms that internal auditors have completed all outstanding work from 14-15 by the end of June, when they finalised the work on the contract management and contract standing orders. However, members are aware that most of the new internal audit work takes place in the second half of the year to fit in with the year-end audit validation work. All internal audit reports will go to the audit subcommittee for consideration in more detail. Financial processes continue to operate effectively as outlined by the performance data on page 171 and 172, and no debtor accounts have been approved for write-off in the first quarter. Members are asked to note the report and request the Treasurer to continue to work with budget managers to maximise savings in 2015-16. I'm happy to take any questions.
Right, well, it sounds like you know what you're talking about. So, are there any questions, colleagues? Usual question for me, on page 169, you've got that list of where we've got our money, who's got hold of our money, and we used to have this AAA, everything's been downrated now, so just give us comfort that you're happy with the security of all of that money.
Yeah, we have obviously a Treasury Management Service Level people called City Council Employee Experts, and they constantly review not only the credit ratings by the relevant companies, the press, the media, and they are in regular contact. If there's any risk or any fear, then we have a period of short-term loans and we would get on them back in the earliest possible time. And if there's any risk or fears, we would make them aware for the earliest possible time.
Thank you. Any additional points? No. Can we agree that item then 5?
Agreed.
Thank you. So we move to 6, purchase of prime movers, 193 to 196. People might not know what these are. So first, just tell those view members what a prime mover is.
Thank you, Chair. As part of the narrative to this report, it was my intention to describe what a prime mover is, but as you request, Chair, I shall attempt to do that now. Simply, a prime mover is it's like a tractor unit. So, like you would see on an articulated lorry, it is the vehicle that tows the articulated lorry, if you like, albeit that the technology is slightly different in so much as this operates on something we call hook and lift. So what it does is it lifts a box onto the back of the prime mover and then it can drop it off using the same hook rather than decoupling an articulated trailer.
Sounds a bit like my car.
Chair, you asked for it, Chair, don't say I didn't warn you. So that's a prime mover, members. The purpose of this report is to seek your approval to purchase 2 new prime movers to replace of the 8 prime movers that we have. 2 of them were along the 93 plates, therefore now are some 12 years old. Now the asset refresh for our operational vehicles is 10 years and they have an expected life cycle, a total life cycle of 15 years. So this is something that we now need to move on with. Draw your attention to paragraph 7, which is at the bottom of page 191. And within paragraph 7, what it states is that over 90% of our fleet now, so the operational response fleet, are Scania vehicles, which is a significant consideration for us in any asset refresh, because what we want to do is to ensure continuity and interoperability with the fleet, and by that it means in terms of spare parts and for mechanics working on the same engines, simplistically, but if your fleet is the same, then it's a more efficient way to manage your fleet. In order to, or the cost of purchasing the prime movers exceed the European procurement threshold, which is 173,000 each prime mover, we anticipate it's going to cost £140,000. Therefore, we need to use a framework agreement, because we through an old procurement process, we couldn't just specify we wanted a single supplier like Scania. The paragraph 11 describes the framework that we are proposing to use. And just to give members some reassurance, paragraph 14. Making the point here, because this procurement would not be subject to a competitive process, the price has been benchmarked against, you can see on the table, the prices of the vehicles in 2012 compared to what they are now in 2015, which is consistent with the CPI increases. Just draw attention to paragraph 18, just to make the point that the authority has a duty to ensure compliance with UK and EU procurement legislation and our own contract standard orders. Therefore, awarding against this established framework will ensure that we remain compliant. Paragraph 19 just details the cost, which is £280,000, but the 2 prime movers, which takes us over the 173,000 threshold, hence the requirement to come here and request your approval, members. So I'll pause at that point. Hopefully I've described in sufficient detail what a prime mover is, but if there are any other questions, members, I'm happy to take them.
Thank you. Have any members, colleagues, got any questions? Can that report and that decision be agreed?
Agreed.
It's agreed. Thank you very much. So we move on to 7, Rural Youth Zone. Now, as has been pointed out, there are some pink papers here. We're not going to refer to any of that. If any members do wish to refer to it, then we'll move into private session. but we'll stay in open session for the time being. So we move on to seven, Youth Seven.
Yeah, thanks, Chair, for introducing the report. The purpose of the report is to request that members confirm their previous in principle decision in reference to Chief Fire Officer Report 4814 to transfer the land released during the building of Birkenhead Community Fire Station to support the creation of the Hive Youth Zone in Birkenhead. And the recommendation that members agree to transfer the land adjacent to Birkenhead Community Fire Station to Will Metropolitan Borough Council for the purposes of building a state-of-the-art youth zone for the improvement of the economic, social, environmental well-being of the area. That's relatively important in regards to those stipulations. And B, agree to the transfer will be at a nominal consideration. And C, approve the creation of a designated youth engagement facility within the youth zone from which Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority can deliver its youth programmes. And again, members will be will understand we deliver a significant number of youth engagement programmes which extend from Beacon Causes, Life Programmes and Prince's Trust, and particularly referencing Prince's Trust in the will, because again, along with Will Metropolitan Borough Council and the Fire Authority have been delivering the Prince's Trust programme from an unsuitable venue, but we would move to something more suitable, and that would be the Hive. Members will also recall that the authority was proposed by Will Borough Council in 2010 to establish if the land adjacent to the fire station is available for the creation of the youth zone, and then fundamentally, you know, given kind of tacit kind of agreement that that land may be available, Will members and officers visited Bolton Lads and Girls Club and also the Witness Youth Zone to look at the suitability of premises to build a youth engagement facility in the Will. Birkenhead Fire Station was considered ideal on that basis, given its neutral location and having fantastic transport links into Birkenhead. And the neutrality of that location is significantly key, particularly when you reflect on the onside model, which is the charity that have been supporting the development of the youth zone, and that being one of the key principles for them to move to that location. On that basis, the authority agreed in principle to transfer the land on two occasions, CFO 182-010 and CFO 04814, of which is attached to Appendix B, subject to the following criteria. An appropriate company being set up, okay, that company has now been established and has charitable status. Funding being finalised and the business plan being agreed. Again, the dependencies include the business plan and the fact that the funding has been established now to support the delivery and the sustainability of the youth zone. The transfer and lease agreement being agreed by the authority, that will be work in progress and again is subject to approval of this report. Finalised agreements on how the fire station and youth zone will work collectively together around a shared vision. If the, you know, the creation of a designated facility within the youth zone for Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority is a way in which we will deliver against that, and as that's stipulated in the following bullet points, it's just to be clarity around that particular point. I'll draw members' attention to the appendices. There are a number of appendices. The first one being the in principle decision 4814. The second appendices is actually the business plan, which details the kind of the financial plan, but also the way of delivering services moving forward. Page 265 is the charity articles of association, which is the establishment of the charity in the first instance, and its focus on what it intends to deliver on behalf of the Will moving forward. And the final appendices, which I'll bring to your attention, is on page 381, which is the Hardy Brack report around the evaluation and the costs associated with that. So we're seeking recommendations subject to authority approval, confirming that the land is available, the documents and the legal documents will be completed, and that land will be given over to Will Metropolitan Borough Council for an order to start the building phase of the work in October 2015, allowing the youth zone to open at the end of 2016. There are no changes to any of the intended partnership arrangements between the authority and the Will Youth Zone and the particular opportunities that lend themselves around the youth facility, but also around the branding opportunities, the opportunities for our staff to engage fully in the delivery of some of those youth activities. And equally, just given the nature of the youth zone, our staff accessing that particular centre. Members will also be aware that, you know, as Deputy Chief Fire Officer, I currently sit as a as a member of the Wimble Youth Zone Board, and I equally am a trustee of the Firefit Hub charity, and I lead on behalf of CFO in regard to children and young people. And these are fantastic opportunities that avail themselves to us, and the creation of that relationship between young people and the fire and rescue service, with the ultimate aim of redressing and subduing small fires and attacks on fire crews in the longer term through the creation of those relationships. In regards to equality and diversity implications, clearly the youth zone's focus will be on a universal provision, but it will also be targeted towards, you know, a number of individuals who would also be the focus of our diversion activities, the disengaged, the disadvantaged, those with disabilities and those from BME backgrounds, or those, you know, from LGBT backgrounds. The principles of the youth zone reflect our own in regards to equality and diversity, promoting accessibility, value cultural diversity, promoting participation, promoting equality of opportunity, promoting inclusive communities, and reducing disadvantage, again, or, you know, things that the authority will be keenly focused on in the delivery of its own services. Staff implications are covered in paragraph 15 through to 18, and really the staff implications are positive ones with regards to their involvement and engagement in the centre, and also our ability to deliver our youth engagement programmes from that particular location. There are some legal implications that I would bring to the attention of members, and clearly some of it is detailed between paragraph 19 to 23, but specifically by virtue of you know, 123 Local Government Act 1972, the authority cannot dispose of land in its consideration for less than can be achieved from the market, unless we have consent from the Secretary of State. The Secretary of State, however, has granted a general disposal consent, which removes the requirement for authorities to seek specific consent for disposal of any land where it's under the value of £2 million or less. And perhaps that's relatively important in regard to our ability to release that land in the first instance. The terms of consent mean that specific consent is not required for disposal of land, as I've said. If approved, the transfer of the land will include an overage provision which will state that if there is a transfer or grant of a lease of the land with the benefit changing from that of the youth zone, then a clawback payment equal to the market value of the land will be paid back to the authority. So there will be a clawback provision should we release the land, and then that be utilised for anything else. We would receive a clawback payment akin to the cost of land as currently is, or as is at the time. A restriction will also be placed on Wirral Metropolitan Borough Council's title, which provides that no disposition or disposal may be registered without the authority's consent. This guards against the transfer of land without the clawback provision being adhered to. This provision will also ensure that the land may only be used as a youth provision, thereby improving the economic, social and environmental well-being of the area. If this use ceases, then the authority will claw back the market value of the land at the time, thereby ensuring that it meets its fiduciary duty to local people. Okay, so, you know, there's some of the work that Sarah's done on behalf of the authority, ensuring that the safeguards are in place for us to release the land on that basis. If the authority chose not to support the project, it may release the capital receipt from the sale of the land, and we have had the independent evaluation, and that, as I say, is the Hardy Black Report, page 381, subject to a freehold interest in the site with benefit of full vacant possession, planning permission being provided, albeit the indication is that, you know, it would have to be for non-food retail fast food developments, and that would clearly take around 9 months for the marketing process. But we haven't at this point sought planning permission on behalf of the authority, given the fact that we have, in two of the previous reports, given in principle commitment to releasing the land to Wirral Metropolitan Borough Council for the provision of the youth zone. And then just draw your attention to paragraph 27, which states, given the commitment already made by members, there would be significant reputational risk to the authority if they rescinded the in-principle agreement without good reason, particularly given the reassurance given by the authority during the previous phases of development. And clearly, you know, the business plan is in place, funding has been achieved, the charity is now being set up and established on the basis of approval from members. So just to return to the actual purpose of the report, is to request that members confirm their previous in principle decision. And that the recommendations are to agree to transfer the land, to agree that that transfer is at a nominal consideration, and to importantly, from a youth provision perspective, approve the creation of a designated youth facility within the youth zone. And I'm happy to take any questions on that, Chair.
Very good, very exciting.
As I mentioned before, I was on the steering committee at the outset of this, been on for a number of years, so I've had the opportunity to speak to many, many people in Wirral and young people in particular. I took quite a few children to the wedding youth zone, also to the Oldham youth zone, and let them see for themselves, because just to try and describe the offer of the youth zone is quite different from actually seeing it live in action for the young people. And they went away. Well, all I could say is my favourite saying is their eyes were out on stalks, basically. They just couldn't believe what they were seeing. And that we were actually going to get one in Birkenhead, which has been a really, really sense of Birkenhead, a really deprived community for such a long time. So this is going to be an absolute massive, it's going to make a massive difference, particularly to young people in central Birkenhead. The north end of Birkenhead where there's a lot of problems with young people. But I've been so blown away by reading a lot of the case histories from the other youth zones of the difference it's made in young people's lives. They've actually changed people's lives and they come back to school having been excluded sometimes, but some other problems as well. The confidence that they've gained from being a member of and supported by the youth zones has enabled them to go back into school and actually achieve and become positive citizens, which can only help us all. I think it's really been really important as well, the granting of the fire service and the connection with the fire service, and it's particularly recognised in Birkenhead as well how important the service is. And all the youth engagement work that the fire service has done has been so welcomed, and this is just going to make it much more positive as well. So I hope this is agreed today because it's the only way forward as far as I'm concerned, and it's going to make an absolutely massive difference. Thank you.
I think it's a great investment for the fire authority to make. It's an investment in the community, not just for the kids, but the fact that the kids are being occupied and in the wider community will have anything in this. And it's a great idea. It shows the diversity in which the authority is working and the kind of work that our people are doing. You know what I mean? We're not there just to put water on fires. We're there for the whole of the community, and it's working. And the diversity in doing this will help us considerable. Thanks, Jim.
Thank you, Chair. I mean, not wishing to really repeat what's already been said, but clearly, you know, it is a fantastic opportunity for young people. It also really will raise the aspirations of those young people from that area, and hopefully from beyond, as we'll bring them in. And on a much, obviously, smaller scale than this, but the fantastic way forward, which we've noticed with young people, particularly in the Wallasey area, since we have the Wallasey Hub, you know, things have really changed. And whilst that doesn't necessarily attract youngsters in from the outer areas of Wallasey, it certainly has made such a big difference in as much as antisocial behaviour as well within that area. So there are only a few things really, but basically it will really start to raise the aspirations of those young people, and as Jean said, Birkenhead and St James's, Bidson St James's ward, one of the, if not the most deprived wards in the whole of the country. It's a fantastic opportunity. And just on a personal note, I just note on paragraph 7, and just in relation to my declaring an interest, you do give mention to a person by the name of John Siverett. John is well known to me personally because we both sit as directors on Mersey Maritime Board. So
any additional contributions, given that there's a lot still to discuss? Is that agreed, colleagues?
Agreed.
Thank you. That's a very good decision. Okay, so additional paper here, item 8, Liverpool City Region, Combined Authority, Governance Arrangements. Chief?
Thank you, Chair. Members, the purpose of this report is for the authority to consider the response which is contained at paragraph 8 of the report, which is on page 5, and for you to agree that response to be presented from the authority to David Parr, who is the Chief Executive of Halton Council, and who has been tasked on behalf of the Liverpool City Region to seek the view of the Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority and the Merseyside Police Crime Commissioner over the potential inclusion of the Fire and Rescue Service and the Police Service into the governance arrangements which should sit under an elected mayor for the Liverpool City Region. Before I go on, members, just bring to your attention this document, which is the Liverpool City Region submission to the Comprehensive Spending Review. And page 22 of this document details the ask in relation to police and fire. So if I just read, I'm conscious that this hasn't been attached as an appendix, so I'll just read for you the outcomes, if you like, the assault, and then the ask specific to fire and rescue and police. The outcomes are to explore closer working between the emergency services and other Liverpool City Region activities to improve and deliver effective and efficient services to local communities, and to explore alternative governance models to secure better commissioning and delivery of emergency services at a local level, and to pursue ambitious reform through collaboration. The asks specifically are twofold. Firstly, to consider whether an elected Liverpool City Region Mayor should take over the role of the directly elected Police and Crime Commissioner for the Merseyside Police Force area, and the role of the Fire and Rescue Authority for the Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service area, and to consider whether an elected Liverpool City Region Mayor should take over the role of the directly elected PCC for the Halton Borough Council area of the Cheshire Police Force, and the role of the Fire and Rescue Authority for the Halton Borough Council area, which currently, in the same way as does the Cheshire Police, sits within Cheshire Fire and Rescue Service, and therefore falls under the auspices of the Cheshire Fire and Rescue Authority. David Parr emailed the Chair and I on the 19th of August. The email is copied verbatim within your report, so I don't propose to speak to anything other than the three options that David outlines. Option one is the status quo, which means the mayor does not take responsibility for fire and rescue or police. Option two is a hybrid, which is contained within the ask, if you like. So I've already spoken to that within the submission to the CSR from the Liverpool City Region. And option three is a change of boundaries, where, for all intents and purposes, Halton comes into Merseyside. That is what would happen. It would be subsumed within Merseyside Fire and Rescue, Merseyside Police. There is some detail within the report which I thought was pertinent to include, paragraphs 4 through 8, which just describe really what Halton is in the context of fire and rescue. Halton ostensibly is one call and witness. Its population is 125,000. It has similar levels of deprivation to St Helens, so to the comparative, if you like, council within Merseyside, or area within Merseyside, is St Helens for the purposes of this report. It does have, whilst it has less rateable properties than St Helens, the rateable value is around the same. The reason for that is, in my view, is down to the number of Comar sites that are located within particularly the Runcorn area on the Western Point Expressway, Casnock Elmer, and a number of other sites there that you'll be familiar with. Back in the day was ICI, so that you'll all be familiar with. with those smaller household names in. Runcorn's got two, sorry, Halton rather has two fire stations called. There's one in Runcorn and one in Lindus. They're both Halton fire stations. The proposed responses are being framed in consultation with the chair and the vice chairs of the authority and myself, and they are their members for your consideration and your approval if you believe that is the appropriate way forward. In relation to option one, the proposed authority response is, in essence, a statement of fact. The authority isn't the opinion or isn't the view that this option would result in the least impact on either the Cheshire or the Merseyside Fire and Rescue authorities. That is a matter of fact. There would be no impact because nothing would change. What that would not do, of course, is deliver full devolution in the context of the ask of the Liverpool City Region. Option two, the hybrid option, which is actually part of the ALDA's reference specifically within the ask. The MFRA view, simply the legal view, is that just isn't possible to deliver under what we understand the auspices of the local government and the devolution, local government devolution bill, the auspices of what that bill will extend to. Unless you specifically want me to, I'm going to explain why, but I can if you need me to. It's all around the mayor having responsibility for precept over six authorities, but that only extended to five in the context of police and fire and rescue. Option three, the response, again, is intended to be factual in so much as that the authority recognised that any advantages to Merseyside that would arise from that option might conversely be disadvantages to Cheshire, not least because we operate, for all intents and purposes, on a per capita based funding model. Our population would increase, Cheshire's would decrease. The rateable value of the properties in Halton would be payable then into Merseyside, not into Cheshire. Simplistic but factual nonetheless. The key point here is, members, is that I felt it was important to stress that ultimately this is a decision for Halton. This is not a decision for Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority. It is a decision primarily for Halton and the five constituent local authorities within the Liverpool City Region. The response goes on to say that the overriding concern of the authority is public safety, preventing incidents and managing risk. The authority recognised that deprivation is a significant determinant in relation to and in specific regard to fires, deaths and any injuries that might arise. Also that the primary focus of devolution is to drive economic growth, that is after all what the Liverpool City Region, the LEP and so forth, that's what these bodies were set up for to achieve in the first instance, and in increasing economic prosperity, that in itself drives down deprivation, which therefore has a positive impact on community safety. What we're suggesting is then that the authority should support any decision of the combined authority that delivers that outcome, because it is directly relevant to our mission. The point is made in response that in the meantime, whilst this is getting worked through and decisions are made, the authority will continue doing what we've always done, and that is to work collaboratively with our emergency service partners and our health partners to deliver the best.